give you a part of a clip which is there out in the internet. Just look at it. I won't show the whole thing.
اللهم إنا نستغيثك ونستغفرك ونتوب إليك ونعوذ الله بك من شرورهم اللهم إنا نستغيثك ونستغفرك ونتوب إليك اللهم فرج عن أسرانا وانصر جندانا اللهم انصر دينك وعلي كلمة لا إله إلا الله بنحر هذا العبد المشرك الرافضي اللهم عليك.
This is some kind of prayer in Arabic. Asking the mercy of Allah for our sins means by slaughtering this apostate who dared to change his religion and to convert to Christianity. Later, it happens. You can see the knife in the right hand of the one who is there, and the guy is in full conscience. He hears. He knows what's going to be there. He doesn't say anything. He doesn't react. He's just like there like a lamb who is going to be slaughtered. And actually this is what happens later. I will spare you the vision. Welcome to the Arab Spring. This was taken in Tunisia. And Tunisia, as you might know, went through a campaign of secularization by two presidents, Bourguiba and Ben Ali, for dozens of years. Yet, under the surface, Islam was not only alive and kicking, Islam is alive and killing, as we can see in this clip and not only in this one. Those who took it actually were proud of what they are doing, and they actually filmed it and put it on YouTube or other sites, because YouTube wouldn't allow such a thing, mainly in order to deter all those who might think about converting to Christianity. This is why they did it, and it might have worked. I have no idea. The question is, if we sum what we heard today, tonight, about the Copts in Egypt, about the Christian churches in Iraq, in Iran, especially the Syriacs, and the Aramaics, the question is why? Why does it all happen? After all, there is a verse in the Quran which says, La ikraha fid din, means there is no compulsion in religion, means Islam is peaceful. They even say time and again that the word Islam actually is some version of salam, means peace, which is totally wrong. Islam is submission, hopefully not by force, but if not, it will be by force. So why does the whole thing happens as we heard? And I've just comment to Ibrahim's presentation. Who knows where the word Copt came from? What is the origin of this word? Does anybody know? This is actually an abbreviation of Egypt, or the name of Egypt. This is the Greek name of Egypt, which came to Copt. And actually, they are the original Egyptians, the masters of the land, and the Bedouins who invaded this country in the 7th century, actually occupied it and converted through a long process its population to Islam. And they kept their original name as Egypt, means Egyptians, original Copts. And this is how Copt came. So the question is, why does it happen in the Middle East? How can we explain it, especially during the last 2 years, where all kinds of democratic wind started to blow in this region, as we saw in the Tahrir Square in Egypt, in the fact that Ben Ali was kicked out from Tunisia, the country of this atrocity, not to mention the newly born democracy in Iraq, which was developed since the occupation of 2003. So if the situation is so good, democracy, why is it so bad? Or why does it get worse during the last few years, in addition to the bloody history which we saw? And this is some kind of complex question. If it's so good, why is it so bad? For this, we have to explain the history of Christians in the Middle East. I won't elaborate much of it, because for this I will need the whole night. But I'll try to fold it to spotlights. Christians actually were the fathers of the modern ideologies all over the Middle East. They actually were the first to bring or to introduce the ideas of nationalism into the Middle East, mainly after they were exposed by getting to Europe and coming back mainly to Lebanon, to the new winds of the nation's spring, which sprang in Europe since 1848, the Metternich era. All kinds of ideologies like nationalism, patriotism, and later socialism, which was translated to Ba'athism, all these isms which were actually brought or imported from Europe, they were those who tried to translate them and to convert them into the environment of the Middle East. Why? Because they hoped that if the original culture of the Middle East, of tribalism on one side and Islamism on the other side, will be converted to nationalism, to patriotism, to socialism, they, as Christians, will find their space as equal and legitimate people. Because Islamism pushes them to second-grade citizens, and tribalism actually definitely marginalizes them because they are not part of our tribes. So these modern ideologies were supposed to re-engineer the Middle Eastern societies in a modern scheme, in a way that everyone will be equal. Muslims, Christians, Jews, Alawis, Druze, if you're an Arab, Kurd, Armenian, Turkmen, whoever you are being stripped from your ancient identity, and everybody becomes nationalist Syrian, nationalist or patriotic Lebanese, or Ba'athist Iraqi, because we become something new, something which will equalize us all, make us all the same people, only because we have the same identity card. This is why Christians were the heralds, I would say, of the these new ideologies, and people who might be mentioned in this context are especially Michel Aflaq, the one of the two who actually formulated the Ba'athism, the socialism, and many others like the Bustani family from Lebanon and others. One who should be mentioned here is the grandfather of Boutros Rali. Boutros Rali, who was the Minister of Foreign Affairs and later the Secretary General of the United Nations, an Egyptian Copt, his grandfather was hung up by the British because he was fighting for Egypt as an Egyptian nationalist. Means Copts in Egypt bought with their blood their Egyptian identity as equal to Muslims. So definitely they were part of the effort to liberate Egypt from the occupation of the others. By the way, Christians, the British, But no, they didn't act like Christians. They act like Egyptians by sacrificing themselves in order to liberate Egypt from the yoke of the occupation of the Europeans. Means definitely they acted according to the Egyptian new mindset, but they did not provide them with recognition by the Muslims as equals, as we see today. Muslims, through history, developed resentment and hatred against Christians and Jews alike. Already in the Quran, there is a verse which says, "Inna din indallah al-Islam," means religion at Allah's is only Islam, means that Islam, in, by its own vision, came to the world not to live peacefully side by side with Judaism and Christianity. It rather came to the world to replace them, to take everything which they had and to Islamize it. This is why, according to the Islamic discourse, Abraham was the first Muslim in the world, and Isaac and Jacob and Noah and Jesus and Johannes were all Muslim prophets. And actually, King Solomon built a mosque in Jerusalem, according to the Islamic version of history. Meaning, after they occupied the territory of this region, they occupied the history and the theology. This is why they had no problem absolutely to build or to turn churches into mosques. It happened in the Temple Mount in the center where the Dome of the Rock is. There was a church over there. They had no problem turning the church of Ramle into a mosque, the church of Damascus into the Umayyad Mosque, and the Hagia Sophia in Istanbul, and many churches in Spain and everywhere. After all, Christianity is void. They don't need anymore those churches. Let those churches become mosques. After all, Christianity passed from the world since Islam came to the world. So the mere existence of Jews and Christians near Muslims was aggravating for them, because what the heck do they still stick to their religions after Islam came to the world to replace them? More of this, they hate the cross, no problem, and no doubt. But the cross where Jesus Christ is being shown on the cross, and many churches and people go around with these crosses, with the image or with the statue of Jesus Christ on the cross, this is much more aggravating for them, because it's actually a human being being worshipped as they view it. So this is definitely an idol worshipping. So if Christians theoretically have the right to live under the yoke of Islam as dhimmis, as second grade citizens, while they worship Jesus Christ as a human being, as a statue, they actually turn themselves into idol worshippers. And this is an idol in their eyes. And if they have the statue of Saint Mary, wherever they have it, in a church, wherever, this is an idol. This is not real. Ahl Kitab means people of the book. So on one side, they consider Christianity as a religion which could be tolerated because they have a book. But in practice, what you see with your eyes, actually, they have idols. This is why these people are idol worshippers. Since they are idol worshippers, you can slaughter them, you can beat them, you can do whatever you like. So this is how they view it, although they wouldn't always say it. Through the years, Islam was more or less defeated, especially since the Reconquista of Spain in the 15th century. They are in constant decline, because Christianity, or what they view as a Christian world, actually occupies a land after another, after Spain, Sicily, Greece, the Sudan, recently the southern part of Sudan came out from the Dar al Islam because it was split and now it's governed by Christians and others. Palestine, of course, in 1948, and then 1967, the Jews dared to occupy Jerusalem. Kuwait in 1991 was taken from Saddam Hussein. Another kind of defeat by the West, who came all the way to the Gulf to fight them. Iraq in 2003, and if you want, Afghanistan as well. All these places for Muslims actually symbolize the fact that they are dominated by the Christians, who should have been subjugated to Islam. So the world is actually upside down. They are being defeated by the Christian world, which actually goes from victory to another. So who is to be blamed? The Christians. Okay, so they cannot act against America because it's too dangerous and America is too powerful. Who is the scapegoat which they can get upon in order to take revenge for all those defeats? The poor Assyrians and the poor Copts, wherever they are in Egypt, in Syria, wherever they are. So actually they are the victims of the failures of Islam. Not only this, if I take another issue of Islam. Islam, as you might know, came to the world in order to replace the loyalties of those who come under Islam. Means the tribalism, to abolish the tribalism and to the ethnicities, because everybody becomes an ummah. Ummat al-Islam means now everybody is defined not by his ethnicity, like Persian and Chechenian and Arab and others, but he will be defined only by his religion. Since we all Ummat al-Islam, means the nation of Islam, you are not anymore an Arab, you are not anymore a Persian, you are not a Baluchi, you are not a Kurd, you are not a Chechenian, we are all Muslims. And this is the idea of Ummat al-Islam. The same with the tribes and so forth. This is the idea of Islam, to unite everyone under the aegis or the umbrella of Islam. This is a total failure. It never succeeded. Ethnicity remained and tribalism remained, and they continued to fight each other on tribal background and on ethnic background through the whole Islamic history. The main idea of Islam, to replace the loyalties of the people, actually is a total failure. When they come to the Christian world, what do they see? States like America, like the United States of America, where refugees came from all over the world, from China, from Africa, from Hispanic countries, from Europe, and they actually succeeded to forge a nation with the idea of the American dream, of life, of liberty, and pursuit of happiness. And they are the most powerful nation in the world, and they occupy us, and technically the biggest or the most prosperous state in the world, means that those Christians succeeded to forge a ummah with an idea exactly where Islam failed. Means the mere existence of a state like the United States of America, Australia, New Zealand, and voila, Israel as well, as a state of refugees who came to this country from all over the world and succeeded to forge a state based on the Zionist idea or the Jewish idea. So Israel and the United States and Australia and all these Judeo-Christian states are actually symbolizing the success of the others and the failure of Islam to become the common denominator of all those Muslims. This is why the mere existence of the state of Israel aggravates them. And America is the biggest Satan, according to them. So this is the mindset of those Islamists. Now, not only this, America and its technology succeeded to penetrate those Islamic societies, mainly through the media, in order to destroy our, means the Muslims, value system by TV, by shows, what goes on in the TV, internet, cell phone. You know, cell phone is the worst thing in the Islamic societies, because a cell phone is a device which enables every 16-year-old girl to talk with whoever she likes about whatever she likes, whenever she likes, without the danger that somebody else at home will pick up the phone and hear that she is talking to a boy. An autonomy to the 16-year-old girl is the most dangerous thing on Islamic societies and Islamic value system. And this is invented by the Christians. In order to undermine the stability and the morality of these societies. This is how they view it. Do you have any other explanation? And I'm not to mention all these satellite channels, the European satellite channels, those with fashion and those without fashion. Okay? What does it mean if not to destroy our moral system? This is how they see. So they didn't only defeat us in the battlefield, they defeated us also at our homes. The bastion which was sealed by the father who controlled everything which his daughter was reading for centuries. Now he lost control because she's watching whatever she likes and she surfs in every website which she likes through the cell phone and through the computer which she has at home. So definitely, this is the ultimate victory of the West, which occupied the most vulnerable organ of the Islamic nation, the 16-year-old girl who wants to look prettier, who thinks about enhancing her figure, who wants to dye her hair, who wants to have nice fashion because she is a girl, because she is a teenager, and she wants to look like the idols which she see on TV and on the internet. And this is something which was designed in the West especially to destroy Islam. This is why, in their view, the Bin Laden campaign against America is actually a defense war, war of defense, to defend Islam from the filth which comes out from the West, from America, from the Christians, in order to destroy our societies. More of this. When they see their own, when they see the situation of their own countries, they come to a very, very sad conclusion. Look, there is a verse in the Quran which says, "Kuntum khayra ummatin ukhrijat linnas." Means you are the best nation which was launched to mankind, which was brought to mankind. This is good translation. Kuntum, means that Muslims are the best nation which was introduced to mankind by Allah. But when this is the verse, of course it should be true. But when they see the situation in their countries of dictatorships, lack of human rights, lack of political freedoms, lack of illiteracy, of unemployment, poverty, corruption, how they kill each other. This is some kind of contradiction with this verse which said that you are the best nation which came to the world. On the other side, they see Europe and America and others, Christians, who are successful, democracies, human rights, political freedoms, prosperity. Actually, something here went wrong. We are the best nation which came to the world, especially according to the Quran. How come we are in such a miserable situation and they, the Christians, are so successful? They envy the West. This is why they hate the West. They envy the Christians. This adds more oil on the fire of hatred against Christians. And here are those poor people in their societies, the Christians, to suffer from their hatred and from their the fact that they envy the West and the Christendom only because of its success to provide good life, political freedoms to its own nations. So when you add all these things, naturally Jews would also suffer. But unfortunately, from their own side, there are no Jews anymore in those countries. So who is there to be the scapegoat? The Christian. And this is what you see here in their attitude to Christians. How long can I... So, to sum. I would add another little point by your permission, my good friend Mordechai Nissan. Today what we see is a major move of population to Europe and to other countries in the world. The Islamic immigration to Europe, which increases day by day, either by immigration or by immigration or by birth rate in Europe. They actually think about tomorrow. They defeated us, we'll defeat them. Their weapon is the womb. Actually, if you know, last year, 2011, more Muslim children were born in France than Christian. In 20 years, the Shnaton, how do you say? The annual group of students, cohorts of 2011, Muslims will be more than Christians. And it increases every year, the rate of Muslim against the Christians. In Britain, women in the age of fertility between 18 and 42, less are married than married. Means like 52% are not married, while 48% more or less are married. So definitely the demography of the West is in decline, while they are actually increasing the number in Europe. If you continue the lines, the charts, you will find that in 20 years, 30 years, some European countries will have Islamic majority. And this will be their victory. Christendom was very successful, but Christendom actually destroyed itself, self-destruction by the culture which exempts the society from reproducing itself. And a society which does not reproduce itself is actually a society which marches very proudly into the museums. And this is what will happen in Europe. Just look at the numbers, look at the figures, and you can very easily figure out what will happen in 30 years. And ladies and gentlemen, many of those who sit here will still be living in 30 years from now. So really, we will see it in our own eyes, how Europe turns into Islam. However, it will happen much earlier, because people from France started to run away from France. I know personally, people, not Jews, Christians who lived in France, who sent their kids already to Japan, to Australia, to New Zealand, because they lost their faith in France. They are more than sure that France is gone, because they are more than sure that those Algerians who come to France, they do not move from Algeria to France. They move Algeria to France. And this is a big difference between both situations. They will start burning churches in Europe when those churches will be too close to their enclaves and neighborhoods. Already we hear today threats even in Britain. There are towns in Britain which have already majority of Muslims. Muslims demand that Sharia law will be implemented on the local level by banning selling of pork in the supermarkets, by banning selling of alcohol in the supermarkets, by banning the sale of contraceptives in pharmacies, because they don't believe that this is legal according to the Sharia law, and they demand it. And since they have the majority, they might have it in maybe a year or two, very near in the foreseeable future. If I will try to fold hatred to Christendom today, is being demonstrated by persecuting the Christian minorities in the Middle East. Yet, because of the immigration to Europe, it will continue in Europe when the European nations will become minorities in their own lands. Thank you very much. Wassalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.
Since we believe in the rights of equality, we have to offer the possibility for the audience, if it deems fit, to ask one or two very brief questions to Moti Kedar. Very briefly. And then we also want to have another comment from Julian. Two, if you have brief questions to Moti Kedar. Yes, go ahead. But brief.
Can you just insert Iran into this entire equation in terms of the persecution of minorities?
Well, if you try to be a Baha'i in Iran, you will be shortened by head. Although there are many Baha'is over there, or Zoroastrian especially, they are clandestine Zoroastrians. There are many in Iran, even in the army and the high-ranking officers. I personally know about one who told me especially, told me personally that he's Zoroastrian, but he wouldn't declare it. And he behaves like a Muslim. He knows how to, like some takia, to behave like the environment in order to save the contiguity between his head and shoulders. So this is, just look at this one. So yes, there are hidden others, yet it's not so easy.
One more.
Our own Christians in our Israeli society, how can we support them in support of other Christians? How can we differentiate and really be brothers? Because when you started the history, the first Christians were Jews, of course. How can we be really, a light into the nations by the way we take care of our Christian community? I know it's too long to respond.
Okay. No. It's very short, the answer. First of all, we, Israelis and Jews, we must change our attitude or traditional attitude to Christianity, because now we are the same boat. Is this explained? The same boat? Bota Sira. In the same ditch. We are the boat. Okay. You know, in Hebrew, in Arabic it's the same ditch. في خندق واحد. Okay, so we are fighting now the same battle. We are now the two sides of the same battle or same struggle against the expansion of Islam over Christendom, and here is the same. So all those who still think that the Christians are the problem of it, I have news for them. Today we are in the same problem, and if we don't cooperate, in Hebrew say, if we don't hang to each other, we'll be hung up one next to the other. Okay, what we have to educate first of all ourselves here in Israel about this, because now we are the brothers of the Christian, because we are in the same problem. We face the same problem, and our faith will be the same if we don't cooperate with them, because this is the only party today in the world which would cooperate with Jews. And unfortunately, not only Jews who are viewing Christendom in this such a way, there are also Christian denominations, some like the Presbyterians, others, who would blame Israel for everything which goes bad in the Middle East. As we saw, part of them are actually part of the BDS movement recently on Caterpillar and other companies. Definitely, they want to appease the Muslims. And you know what Churchill once said about appeasement, okay? If you try to appease a crocodile, you actually hope that he will eat you the last. Okay, you don't, he won't be your friend. He might be, you know, waiting for a minute until he devours you. Okay, so appeasing today the radical Muslims or those Muslims definitely is useless and no point.